One example of the implications is the fact that Google works so well. And that can be explained by the fact that the web has a long-tailed degree distribution instead of a bell curve degree distribution. Google is able to rank its pages that it responds to for your query by giving preference to web pages that have many inlinks, that is, many other web pages point to them. Google assumes that if a web page has many pages that point to it, then it's more likely to be a good response to your query. It's more likely to be, say, authoritative. The reason this works is because at every level of the network, you have some pages that have many links to them and many other pages that have few links to them. So no matter what your query, Google will be able to find pages that have relatively many links to them and thus can put them high up in the list. Whereas if the web was a random network, then all of the web pages would have about the same number of links, the average of the bell curve, and Google would have no way to discriminate among them to decide how to rank the answers. Now, the web was not designed by anyone. It built itself, it self-organized. And it just happened to self-organize in this way so that it has this kind of long-tailed degree distribution, and Google took advantage of that. This same notion explains some of the success of other networks in nature. The fact that they have long-tailed distributions is taken advantage of and becomes useful for organisms and social systems as well. And you can read about that in some of the suggested readings on the course materials website. The obvious question is, how does this structure of scale-free networks arise? If the web wasn't designed by any person or committee of people to be that way, how did it become that way? Well, there's multiple hypotheses. One prominent hypothesis is called preferential attachment. It's the idea that the rich get richer. That is, if you're coming in and you have a new web page and you want to decide who to link to, you're more likely to link it to a page that already has a lot of links to it, just because that page is more likely to be found by you. Similarly, the next time somebody else comes along and wants to link to a page, that page will be even more likely to be linked to because now you've linked to it, and so the number of links to it have increased, and so on. So this is the idea. The rich get richer. The linked to get more linked to. The cited get more cited. That's what happens in science, at least. And by cited, I mean C-I-T-E-D. That is, many people cite the papers that have already been cited by many people. We're going to be looking at a Netlogo model of preferential attachment. And here's how that model works. We start with two linked nodes. At each time step, we create a new node. The new node is going to randomly choose one of the existing nodes to link to, but it has a bias. The more links the existing node has, the more likely it is to be chosen. For example, each one of these existing nodes has one link coming out of it. And so each has an equal chance here of being linked to by this node. So let's say that this node randomly chooses this other node to link to. Okay, at the next time step, we have a new node, and it has a choice to make, but this node in the middle here has two links coming out of it, whereas each of these other nodes has one link. So the nodes with one link only have a 25% chance of being picked, whereas the node with two links has a 50% chance of being picked. And here, this node picked it. And this continues. So let's see what that model looks like. Here's the interface for preferentialattachment.netlogo, which is one of the models in the Netlogo models library. So you can get it there, or else you can download it from our course materials page. So I'm going to set up, and if I go once, we have our third node comes in and links to that node. Go once again. Well, you can see this is going to start to look kind of messy. And in fact, if I keep going, we get a big mess. But this has a nice feature, which is you can click layout on. Now if I do setup and go, it actually creates a very nice layout for the network, although it's a little bit slower to run. So you can see this going, just doing that bias, that biased choice. Each time a new node is created, it makes a biased choice among the nodes that exist. And you can see that there's a big hub forming here in the middle, and little hubs down here, and inside the little hubs, there's even littler hubs, and so on. And if we just let this run, it's going to turn into a very nice scale-free network. And you can see the degree distribution here, which has the characteristic power law looking shape. And when it's plotted on a log-log plot here, it's making a straight line. And as more and more nodes are added, these will look more and more like actual power laws. So this model is more to look at rather than to actually do experiments with, but I recommend downloading it from the course materials page and playing with it. The interesting thing here is that such a very simple model of network formation can produce networks that look very much like real-world networks. So there might be something to this hypothesis of how these kinds of networks form.